There are many myths and understatements around the neck humps. Surely you have heard of terms like Dodger's hump or Buffalo hump, but the internet is full of contradictions, so I will try to explain these issues step by step and, as you know me, basing on scientific reports. My name is Kate, I'm a physical therapist, and welcome to my channel. Let's start with the fact that terms like Dodger's hump, Buffalo hump, or even neck hump are medical colloquialisms. This means that such terms are not disease names in the official disease classifications. Currently, most countries around the world use the ICD-10 classification, which is the International Classification of Diseases. It contains codes of letters and numbers that represent specific diseases, signs, and symptoms. If we try to search for Dodger's hump, Buffalo hump, or neck hump, it turns out that these terms do not have codes assigned to them. The ICD-10 classification is to be replaced by the ICD-11 classification in January 2022. ICD-11 will be much more comprehensive and will include diseases that have not yet been classified. But you won't find terms like Dodger's hump, Buffalo hump, or neck hump in it either. What does it mean? Nothing else than the fact that these terms are colloquial expressions. So you will not get a diagnosis of Dodger's hump or of Buffalo hump from your doctor because there are simply no such diseases. There are no clear guidelines what criteria should be met to call anything a neck hump, a Dodger's hump, or a Buffalo hump. The fact that these are unofficial expressions causes a lot of chaos because everyone uses them as they please. So you may come across the information that Buffalo hump and Dodger's hump are the same. But in the same internet, you may find the information that Dodger's hump and Buffalo hump are totally different. They have different bases and different appearance. And really, you can go crazy. However, we see different humps on people's backs. The problem is that each hump you see over here has a slightly different background. First, let's take a look at neck humps, the inside of which is a fat tissue. There are two main groups of patients here. The first group are HIV positive patients who experience so-called lipodystrophy. It is a common complication of highly active antiretroviral therapy and manifests itself with altered fat distribution, particularly lipohypertrophy of the dorsal cervical fat pad. Here is an example of such neck hump in a patient with HIV. Why is this happening? Well, evidence suggests this may be related to the structural analogy at the molecular level between HIV medications and proteins involved in lipid metabolism. These types of humps are removed with the help of plastic surgery. Here you have another example, less obvious, but it is also a patient with HIV-related lipodystrophy. Here is a photo of the same patient after the surgery. This type of neck hump is often referred to as a Buffalo hump, but as you already know, it's a colloquial term and actually does not bring much to the matter. Another group of patients whose hump on the neck is fat are patients with Cushing's syndrome. A characteristic picture of Cushing's syndrome are thin arms and legs, central obesity, characteristic stretch marks, moon face, and a fatty hump. Often referred to as a Buffalo hump, sometimes even in some scientific publications on Cushing's syndrome. A certain hormone, cortisol, also known as the stress hormone, plays the most important role in this syndrome. We distinguish both Cushing's disease and Cushing's syndrome. And without going into details, it is worth knowing that hormonal disorders related to cortisol can be caused in several ways. It can be caused by overuse of cortisol medications, glucocorticoids, as seen in the treatment of chronic asthma or rheumatoid arthritis, or it can be caused by an excess production of cortisol from a tumor in the adrenal gland or a tumor of the pituitary gland. And now examples. Here we have a pediatric patient with drug-induced Cushing's syndrome. In this case, betamethasone was overdosed. Here is another example of drug-induced Cushing's syndrome. This patient was taking prednisone as an asthma medication. Here's an example of pediatric patient with endogenous Cushing syndrome. And finally, a media publicized example of a woman diagnosed herself with Cushing's disease, which in her case was the result of a tumor on her pituitary gland in the brain. Interestingly, a fatty hump is also seen in some people who are simply extremely obese. They also experience redistribution of fat tissue around the cervicothoracic junction. The reason for this is unknown, but most likely these are patients whose hormonal balance is disturbed, but they have not yet been well diagnosed. Treatment of fatty humps starts with the good diagnostics, because as you can see, there can be many reasons for their formation. Only when we know what caused the anomaly in the distribution of fat tissue can we proceed. Contrary to the false opinion spread on the internet, you will not reduce a fatty hump with few simple exercises for the spine, because it is not the spine that is the main problem in these cases, but we will talk more about it in a moment. Now let's move on to the second group of the neck humps, the presence of which is usually associated with incorrect posture habits and bad position of the spine. They are often referred to as a Dodger's hump, although, as I mentioned before, the name itself doesn't tell much. This type of back hump usually covers not only the cervical spine, but also and even mainly thoracic spine. And it can be described as an increased thoracic curvature called kyphosis or hyperkyphosis or a hunchback, which can be present in a variety of conditions. When we hear hunchback, the first one that comes to our mind is, of course, Quasimodo, the famous bell ringer from the Cathedral of Notre Dame. And of course, he is a fictional character, but the author, Victor Hugo, who wrote the novel Notre Dame de Paris, gave us some tips on what the main character could suffer from. Scientists indicate that he may suffer from a certain type of mucopolysaccharidosis, which is a metabolic disorder also affecting skeletal system. His back was unnaturally arched, and most likely it was a combination of kyphosis and scoliosis called kyphoscoliosis. But when we think about hunchback, about slouching, we also think about something which is really popular nowadays, about constantly looking at monitors, at smartphones. This is called an upper cross syndrome, in which the arms protrude farther, the head protrude farther, and our thoracic kyphosis is enlarged. Most often it is the result of incorrect postural habits and dyskinesia within the shoulder blades. Appropriate exercises supporting the correct kinetics of the scapula help to get rid of the problem. If you are interested in this particular issue, I have recorded a separate video about it, which you can find somewhere here. Increased kyphosis may also appear in the elderly, who suffer from reduced bone density and spine compression fractures as a result of osteoporotic changes. Such changes are usually degenerative in nature, which means they are permanent and difficult to correct with the exercises. But increased thoracic kyphosis is also part of many serious spine diseases, such as ankylosing spondylitis or Scheuermann's disease. In the case of these diseases, the abnormal curvature of the thoracic spine is usually fixed, and such a hump cannot be easily corrected with simple exercising. Finally, in some patients, we can observe a hump in the area of the cervicothoracic junction. Patients often report that they feel a bone sticking out here. This bone is nothing but a spinous process of the C7 vertebra. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, last cervical vertebra. This is the spinous process, C7 spinous process. This process can be seen when looking at the patients from the side, over here, especially if a patient has a flat cervical lordosis, which is sometimes called a flat neck syndrome. Here is an example of my patient with the total loss of cervical lordosis and even with the kyphotization of this section of the spine. And in some head positions, the cervicothoracic junction is clearly visible and we can see a neck hump. Generally, the loss of cervical lordosis in this particular patient does not give any symptoms, and she came to me only with a cosmetic defect caused by the prominent C7 spinous process in the form of a hump. Working with such patient who has a flat cervical lordosis is usually an attempt to restore a neutral physiological cervical lordosis, and this is a really simple case, so there is nothing dangerous forming here on the back. Okay, so we discussed the neck humps, or rather back humps, which can be associated with the spine or posture. And yes, with these types of humps, there is actually a physiotherapy that we can try. We can try exercises, we can try postural re-education, we can try different forms of physical therapy. Of course, if the changes are permanent, there are methods of surgical treatment that are used. But what I wanted to draw your attention to is the fact that on the internet, you can find content that paints all the neck humps with the same brush, which is a big mistake. Often you can see videos that are showing some simple exercises for the neck, which are supposed to relieve your pain and reduce your neck hump. These are often clickbaits like fix your neck hump with these 5 simple exercises, or get rid of the Dodger's hump or buffalo hump in 5 minutes, which is totally absurd because as you can see, there are many different humps with different etiology. And with all the respect to these producers, not every hump will be helped by exercises. Content like this is mixing terms, and it is very confusing, and even the thumbnails of the videos can mislead the viewer. For example, there is one particular photo from the Shutterstock, which is very commonly used, showing a woman's fat hump before and after aesthetic medicine treatment. And this photo is used in the videos ensuring that exercises for this hump will help, which is not necessarily true, because if it is a fatty hump, then the cause may lie somewhere else than in postural habits, muscle strength, or spinal positioning. And really be careful and do not self-diagnose. Just take a look at these two examples. At first, they look really, really similar, right? But here is my patient in whom the hump is just a C7 spinous process, in whom physiotherapy is able to do the job in few sessions. But on the other side, we have a patient with very serious cancerous Cushing's, who no matter how much she exercised, it wouldn't help her. As a physiotherapist, of course, I encourage you to take all forms of exercise. But remember that medicine is really not a 0-1. And sometimes following the content on the internet, you may miss a really serious illness. So if there is a suspicious thickening on your neck, a hump or whatever you call it, go to see a doctor, run a diagnosis. Unfortunately, the internet is not a place for diagnosis of humps, and even less for their treatment. That's what I wanted to tell you. Links to all the sources that I used during the production of this material can be found in the description of the video, as usual. And if you like the movie, you can appreciate my work by giving me a thumb up, leaving a comment, and by subscribing to the channel. Thanks for watching, and bye!